Retro.
No.
Hi, this is Emily Swallow, the armorer in The Mandalorian. You're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. This is the way.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Happy Life Day, and welcome to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And it's a time for a look at some Star Wars news. But first, Jay can remind everybody where we can be found around the internet.
Absolutely, Dennis. And a happy life day to everyone. We are on Twitter, or X these days, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
Okay, the dish is aligned. The life day orbs are prominently displayed. The signal's boosted to maximum output. We have our red ceremonial robes on. The shield is down. We are now broadcasting to the galaxy. So once again, happy life day. Jay, you got any big plans to celebrate this Star Wars holiday?
Well, I'll tell you what, these red robes are very, very comfortable, I must say. The Wookiees had it right when they picked these out. But there
I'm surprised
is
they had one in your size.
I know. I had to hem it a little bit, though. So okay. It's all good. But there's a quiz on StarWars.com, which was kind of fun, that I already took. And it was the, which High Republic character will you be spending Life Day with? So I thought that was an interesting little like morph between, you know, the Wookiee Life Day tradition and the High Republic. So you answer, you know, those few little questions. Would you rather do this, 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 or this? And so I ended up with spending Life Day with Vernestra Rowe. And so it says, Vernestra is taking some time for herself, but a little Life Day celebration may be just what she needs to heal her heart so she can continue to help others in need. So kind of
yeah
fun.
She definitely needs some help
after
everything that's happened in the High Republic recently. So
indeed.
Yeah, I don't have any other big plans. I am sure I will have Star Wars on quite a bit, though. I am not going to watch the holiday special, maybe the Lego holiday special, but not the original. So one,
can't
it's just easier to find
to
a Disney
do it, huh?
Yeah, so but we'll see. And then there's of course the Holiday Legends book that George Mann and Kevin Scott did, I think.
Mm-hmm.
Or was it just George Mann? I can't remember, that we talked about last year. And there's other fun ways to celebrate Life Day with Star Wars. So I'll be indulging in some of those. But
absolutely,
let's go ahead and get into the news. And last week when we were recording the news, we had the breaking news that the SAG-AFTRA strike was over because they had come to an agreement with studios. And the instructions went out at that time that all the studios could get back to work, that all strike activities were to cease. A number of projects and productions across all kinds of genres have gotten back into work or about to get back into work. And so I wanted to talk a little bit about what that meant for Star Wars. And quite frankly, when it comes to the shows and stuff, I'm not entirely sure. I've seen lots of rumors and suggestions out there, but we know that Andor season 2 was getting ready to start shooting right before the writer's strike happened. We know the Acolyte had been shooting but needed to do some work, and Skeleton Crew was getting close to being done or was about done. So I expect all three of those probably soon will be getting back to work and trying to finish things up in some cases. And then the big one is that season 4 of The Mandalorian, I don't know if you've caught wind of any of the stuff that's going on. There's all kinds of crazy rumors, Jay, out there about what's going on with The Mandalorian. Mm-hmm. So I recommend everyone take that with a grain of salt. I've also seen offhanded comments by some of the actors being interpreted as Mandalorian 4, season 4 is ramping up. So I don't know. Like I said, that one seems a little out there when it comes down to it. But
mm-hmm.
Yeah, yeah. And of course, we had all those movies that were announced. And so presumably one of those should be getting ready to go pretty soon.
Yes, yes. And I know there's, as you said, there's so much out there that people are talking about. And well, first of all, oh, happy day, you know, that mm-hmm. this is finally over, and super happy for everyone involved. And hopefully everybody is happy with the results of what they went through there. The one, though, I have to say is, did you see Katie Sackhoff's post? It was a throwback Thursday on Instagram that she was holding her daughter when they first got her. And she had her Bo-Katan wig on. Did you see that one?
Yeah, definitely.
And she kind of hinted about, oh, can't wait to wear this wig again. So I was like, all right, that's cool.
Yeah, yeah. She's really excited to potentially be in season 4 of The Mandalorian. Yeah. So she's made no bones about that. Some of the other things that, of course, have happened around the strike, and I don't know if anyone's noticed, but there hasn't been any episodes of the Star Wars show or the High Republic show over on StarWars.com since the strike happened. And I've been a little unclear as to why that was, but it looks like Christina Ariel, in the case of the High Republic show, there's pictures on her social media of her supporting the SAG-AFTRA strike. I don't know if she's a member or what the situation was, but with her support of that, that meant she wasn't filming the High Republic show. Right. And we'll get into some High Republic news here in just a bit, because phase 3 is officially kicked off now, and there's a lot of stuff out there. We were past due for a new episode of the High Republic show. Oh, yeah. And with the beginning of phase 3, you kind of expected to get one, and it's just not there. So I don't know if we're going to be getting one from her in the near future or what the case may be, but there's things like George Mann and Kevin Scott interviewing each other over on StarWars.com. There's other kinds of stuff like other things that have to do with the High Republic, and we'll be talking about some of that here in just a bit. But so anyways, maybe we'll start getting those back. I don't know what the plans for those shows are going forward.
Yeah, and I hope so, because those were a lot of fun. And Christina Ariel is just, she's got such a fun personality, and she always brought so much light to all of the High Republic stuff. So it'll be nice to be able to see that again, and hopefully they'll be bringing that to us.
Yeah, especially when you sit back and think for a second that the last High Republic show we got was the San Diego Comic-Con preview show, which basically they made an announcement that there was going to be announcements at San Diego Comic-Con. Yeah. And then, of course, the strike happened, and then none of the movie actors were San Diego Comic-Con. So
exactly.
It would be fun to hear from a lot of these creative types on the High Republic show again. So mm-hmm. hopefully we'll get something like that soon. Mm-hmm. Okay, but here's the fun part. Now the strike is over, we've got all these actors that were in Ahsoka that have social media presences, because not all of them do, that are now able to talk about it on social media. And this has been quite fun. You know, some general themes from them, and then actors from other projects that are Star Wars and non-MCU and other things related, is like how grateful they are to the fans, which has been really cool. You know, expressing their love and appreciation for the support during the strike, and for talking about their shows when they could not, and those type of things. So that's been really cool.
Oh, yeah. And it's so great to see all of the joy that they're bringing to these posts, and all of the memories that they were able to finally share about things. And I know you have several of these in our notes, so I can't wait to dive into them. And some of them, of course, are very bittersweet, because, of course, we lost Ray Stevenson. And so it was hard to see him in some of those videos and whatnot. But it was also very comforting to see him in action, and just to know how beloved he was, too.
Yeah, and they all, you know, not only, you know, expressed, you know, how much they missed Ray Stevenson, but they were also talking about Shauna Tripchak as well.
Yes.
How much they missed her too. So that was kind of something that was universal across them. But mm-hmm. let's lead on. We're not going to go through everything that everyone's posted on social media, because that's a visual thing. But we just kind of thought we'd hit some of the high points here, starting on with Amon Asfandi. Okay, I did not realize how much of a Star Wars fan he was before he got the role of Ezra Bridger. Did you?
No. Oh my gosh. Yeah. When I started seeing these posts by him, and I'm like, dude, you are one of us, like 100,000%.
Yeah. Cause he's got these, I put them in our notes in reverse order, but he has some images of him at Disneyland at Galaxy's Edge swinging around a purple lightsaber that looks like it came out straight out of Savi's workshop, because it's doing the different flashing type stuff that those lightsabers do. And I thought that was pretty cool. Yep. And then there's another one with him swinging that lightsaber around while he's on a boat. at sunset.
Yeah. That was beautiful. Oh my gosh, mm-hmm. It was so beautiful.
Yeah, I thought that was really cool. But he has a great collection on his Instagram account of shots from behind the scenes of doing Ahsoka. And one of them is him in his stormtrooper gear when he was in disguise, escaping from the night troopers on Peridia. And then there is one where he's in, they're wearing production robes. That's him, Rosario Dawson, and Natasha Liu Barduzzo, and they're all just kind of posing, which was a scream.
Hilarious.
Another one of him practicing with his saber. There's some great stunt choreography. A scene of Natasha and Ivana just goofing off, dancing to some music during a break between shots and takes. Mm-hmm. Practicing that leap. A birthday celebration. Posing with the stormtroopers. And then perhaps the funniest thing of all of this is Ivana Sokno sitting in one of those mini kids land speeders. Like, she can't even really fit in this thing. She's got her outfit on. She's smoking a cigarette with her sunglasses on. It just stoically drives off in this thing.
I'll tell you what, that little land speeder has gotten a lot of mileage, literally and figuratively. And I have seen that particular shot with Ivana turned into so many pieces of fan art. Mm-hmm. People have started doing like fun little prototypes of toys. But did you see the one of Hayden Christensen in the land speeder as well? Like, he's sitting on the front of the land speeder as Anakin, and he's just pure joy. He's got his arms up in the air and he's got this look on his face like, woohoo! And there's somebody that's driving it in a mask, someone that was on set. Mm-hmm. And he just looks like he's just living his best life. So that land speeder must have been like the thing to take around set. It was so much fun. And I saw that on the amazing Hayden Christensen Instagram.
Oh, okay. Yeah, as I say, Hayden doesn't have social media.
No, he does not. But amazing Hayden Christensen on Instagram does a very, very nice job of cataloging all of his whereabouts and up to's.
Yeah. But I got to tell you, I was really enjoying the video he had, Aman, Asfandi, that would be, of the stunt choreography that they were doing and all the practicing that they were doing to do that fight that takes place there in Peridio when he doesn't have his lightsaber yet. That looked really incredible.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. Yeah, between he and Natasha Liu Bordizzo doing all of their fight scenes and their stunt coordination, wow, so impressive. I love all that behind-the-scenes stuff anyways, and it's just so cool to see it from their perspective and to see how excited they are about sharing, you know, the things that they were able to do, and it's just so impressive to see.
Mm-hmm. I'll try and include a link to some of these posts that we're talking about, but if you want to find Aman Asfandi, he's at Aman Asfandi on Instagram. Okay, so Natasha, on her Instagram page, and she's at Natasha Liu Bordizzo, I thought this was cool. She has a collection of some of her favorite Ahsoka fan art out there. And so she clearly was into it. That was pretty neat.
Oh, yeah. And all of that fan art, of course, is so near and dear to my heart. I mean, anybody that's listened to this podcast for any length of time knows how much I support artists and, you know, the work that they do, and whether that is hand-drawn or digital or whatever. So I was actually going through every single one of those posts and like, I'm going to follow this person and I'm following this person. So thank you, Natasha, if you're listening, because I have a lot of new artists to follow now.
Yeah, definitely. There's some really good ones there. And then, you know, some of the stills that she has on another Instagram post include her with Rosario Dawson and Huang in the cockpit of the Jedi shuttle, and then another one of her posing with Ivana, some saber rehearsal, posing with stunt doubles, another video capture things, and then just some various other set stuff, and then a great picture of Aman Asfandi with a Where's Ezra sticker being held up by him. So that was pretty cool.
That was great. Definitely.
Yeah. And then Ivana Sokno, who's at Ivana Sokno on Instagram. It makes it real convenient for all of us to find these things.
Definitely.
You know, she simply had a message. It's, you know, like, it says, thank you for everything. It means a lot. And, you know, she's thanking the people that were behind the Ahsoka and the fans. And then the shot of her is, it looks like she's kind of sitting in the volume and it's, she's, you know, you got the shot of her from behind, but she's kind of got her legs stretched out in front of her and her hands, you know, she's supporting herself by leaning back on her hands. So that was cool. One of my favorites though was Diana Lee and Sonata, and Asanto rather, and just, you know, this really, it's her in her costume, I'm guessing like in her trailer or dressing room somewhere, and just the depth that she goes into, how, you know, she's a late in life actor after raising a son with some autism and being really appreciative of the chance that she was given to embody this role of Morgan Elsbeth, and how, you know, Dave Filoni and John Favreau and the likes took a chance on her and saw that what she was capable of. And it was just so heartfelt that it was really quite cool to see.
Oh yeah. That one hit me in all the feels. And honestly, by the end of that post, I was tearing up because I could totally understand where she was coming from, you know, and I even responded back to her, and, you know, whether she reads it or not, or, you know, it's fine. But just saying that I understand how she feels, because with me personally with cosplay, that's, I came into it very late as well. And so sometimes you just don't know how that's going to be received and how you're going to be able to come off to other people. And, you know, just the whole thing with her son, oh my gosh, just so, so beautiful. And I was so impressed with just that, as you said, just the depth of that heartfelt sentiment that she put into that. So yeah, that was so awesome. And I have to go back just really quickly to Ivana's picture there in the volume. Gorgeous, stunning, stunning picture. I mean, if she doesn't frame that one for herself, I mean, that's epic. It was epic.
Yeah. Yeah. It looks like she's just looking out over the mountains. So that was pretty cool. And the other thing I liked about Diana's post is, like, you know, she was talking about that final saber fight that she got to have with Rosario, you know, with the Blade of Talzin. So that was pretty cool. Rosario Dawson was a little bit later in posting something there, but she did a really neat compilation of photos of her with Ashley Eckstein and Ariana Greenblatt, and just kind of thanking them for being like the Ahsoka team. And, you know, she made mention how Ashley was there on set and was available to talk to about what it was to portray that character. And then made mention of how Ariana was a great feisty young warrior Ahsoka. Mm-hmm. And how much fun it was to watch her do that performance as well. Great picture of her and Ariana hugging. You could just see how genuine that one was. And then, you know, she also genuinely thanked the fans. So a neat little post from her.
Oh, for sure. Yes. And everything about all of those posts was just able to just see how much it meant to all of them and just how much fun they were able to have too, which is just heartwarming.
Mm-hmm. And then there was Ariana Greenblatt. Now, her stuff is over on X, and that's at Ariana G. And she just doesn't have much recently from her on her Instagram account. But I thought of you, Jay, when I saw this one, because there is a picture of her and Rosario Dawson both dressed up as Ahsoka. And the post reads, "For Ro, for Day, for the fans, hashtag Tano Tuesday, hashtag Ahsoka lives." And so that hashtag Tano Tuesday, I was like, Jay uses that one. Oh, yeah. Jay Snips cosplay. So
I sure do. And oh my gosh. Yeah. This one made the rounds over to Instagram as well. And I've seen this one on so many different accounts, and someone picked it up and did an actual digital interpretation drawing of it, which was fantastic. So yeah, it was beautiful to see the two of them just back to back, arms crossed. You know, and I've done a very similar pose with one of my good cosplay friends as well, in almost that exact same kind of pose. So it was just like, oh my gosh, this looks so familiar. So beautiful. And then another one was that 3:32 one where she's standing in front of all the clones.
Yeah.
Ariana. Oh my gosh, that's so great.
Yeah. But back to the one with her and Rosario. I don't know how it's possible, but those two standing back to back in their full makeup and full costumes made them each look even better than they did when they were in the show. I don't know what it is about that image, but it just is, it's really quite incredible, really quite striking.
I agree. Yeah, I could not stop staring at that picture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I also like the one with her standing in front of the clones from the 3:32. And then she had her final post, which is like, you know, from my family to yours, thank you, thank you, thank you for all the loves and support, comments, reactions, and just overwhelming love you've all shown me. The cast and 600 plus crew members, artisans who worked on the Ahsoka Shadow Warrior. So, you know, I'm deeply grateful to the Star Wars family. And then she signed it Snips. And that's a picture of her, Dave Filoni, John Favreau, Hayden Rosario, and a random dog. I'm not sure whose dog that was.
It's a lucky dog.
Yeah, but a pretty cool picture. So anyways, this whole conversation was not to give you a tour of Instagram and social media, but just kind of highlight, this is what we've been missing for the past several months. And it was so unfortunate that, and I don't have to be careful how I say this, because the strike was important and it secured the livelihood of a lot of important people and these actors. And that is not to be overlooked. But it embodied the entirety of the show that we've talked about so much here on Podcast Stardust. And not the actors that were involved and the people that were involved not being able to appreciate that adulation while the show was being aired, I think it was just unfortunate for them because, you know, it's like we talked about it. A lot of podcasts talked about it. But, you know, in that moment when it was at its height of popularity, as it was airing, they couldn't embrace it. They couldn't get the most out of it, I guess is what I'm trying to say.
Right.
And I just think that that was unfortunate because, you know, and everyone has their own opinions, but I think that I just thought it was an incredibly fantastic series. And I would have loved for them to be able to interact with that a bit more. Because so many of them were touring and at conventions while this was going on, and they couldn't talk about it in panels or anything.
Yeah, and that had to be so hard. And you put that so well, very well said, Dennis. And, you know, I mean, I think about it from the respect of, imagine, you know, your son graduating from high school and you're not able to talk about it with anyone. You're not allowed to share any pictures of it with anyone. And at the height of that emotion of everything that you're seeing everyone else being able to enjoy the fruits of your labor that you're not able to even talk about. I mean, that had to be so hard. So I'm just so, so thankful that they're able to get back out there and share all of these things. And in some ways it almost makes it, and again, you know, like you, I want to be careful how I say this, but it almost makes it even more meaningful at this point, just knowing, you know, how much they wanted to talk about it and they couldn't.
Yeah.
And it's just, So I've been so impressed and I'm so grateful for all of these posts.
Yeah. And it was nice seeing them all respond to each other on their posts as well, which was fun because you could tell
tagging each other and
and how all the genuine affection that they had for each other. And it was apparent like in the videos when you got to see them dancing and doing stuff about how much fun they were having doing this and how well they all got along. Okay. We need to get on with some more news. We could probably talk about that all evening, but we do have a lot of High Republic stuff we want to cover here. And first up, The Eye of Darkness. So the first novel in Phase 3 by George Mann hit store shelves on November 14th. Jay, you and I were talking a little bit offline, and I know you haven't had a chance to dive into this yet, or at least I believe that's the case. Mm-hmm. But I'm 100 pages into this, and it's a 399-page book. And all I can say without spoiling anything is like, it's so good to have these characters back. You know, I loved Phase 2, but we were left with so many unresolved questions at the end of Phase 1. What was going to happen to all these people that finally getting to catch up with them in Phase 3? It's like, it is like going back to those long lost friends in some respects.
Oh, that is fantastic. And I am so excited, even more excited now to jump in. So yeah, I need to pick that up, you know, with Life Day here and the other holidays fast approaching. I'm hoping I'm going to be able to carve some time out because I've seen some other chatter on Instagram and such, and everyone is just singing the praises of this book. And I'm so here for it.
Mm-hmm. And then in other High Republic news over on StarWars.com, they now have a chronological reading order for all of the High Republic content. So it starts with stuff that happened in Phase 2, goes all the way through Phase 1, and then all the material that we've got so far in Phase 3. So if you ever had a question as to, well, should I read this comic before that novel, or this young adult novel before that middle grade book, or that, you know, think of all the different content that we had for all this, the audio dramas and stuff like that. This tells you what order you're supposed to reading it all in to make it all make sense chronologically. So not going to dive into the details. You can look it up yourself at starwars.com, and I'll maybe put a link in on the show notes on that. But if you have questions, they've answered that for you. So that was pretty cool.
Yeah. I think that's a great idea because, you know, there is so much material and media out there that sometimes too, it's easy to let some of that stuff just slip through the cracks. Mm-hmm. And not to say that, you know, everyone has to gobble up every last, you know, novel and middle grade and comic and, but, you know, if you feel like, you know, I want to fill in a gap here, or I want to dive more into these characters there, then it's a great resource.
Yeah. I actually found a few comics from like mainly the High Republic Adventures type stuff that I hadn't actually picked up yet, thanks to that order. Hey. And so I went ahead and ordered those on Amazon.com. So
perfect.
Yeah. Okay. Well then, as we were mentioning, there hasn't been any High Republic shows with the Phase 3 kicking off. And some of the things they've done to kind of fill in the gaps there is that they put a couple stories in there introducing us to some of the new characters that we're going to meet in Phase 3. Last week on the news, we discussed the updated looks for a number of our returning characters, but now we get to meet some new ones. And up first, we have Jedi Master Miro Lox and Padawan Amadeo Azazo. I'm thinking I got that last name right. A-Z-Z-A-Z-Z-O.
That's how I said it in my head. So I think you're good.
So they first made an appearance in Lydia Kang's short story, The Call of Coruscant, which is in the Tales of Light and Life anthology, which I have not gotten to yet because I didn't want to start that until I finished From a Certain Point of View, Return of the Jedi, which we still have 5 stories to go. So anyway, but they are making appearances in The Eye of Darkness, and they have described as not having really been involved with the Nile before now because their assignments were elsewhere in the galaxy. Michael Siglain, who's one of the vice president over Lucasfilm, is in charge of this, said that, you know, one of the reasons they chose to add these two is because they lost so many Jedi in Phase 1. They needed more characters. Like,
now,
whose fault was that, Michael?
Yeah, exactly. I know. I read that and I had to chuckle because I'm like, oh, gee, where did that problem come from?
Right. Killed some of our favorites there. Yeah. But then Miro, if I was going to describe him, he's kind of more of a built looking Jedi. He's looks like he spent a fair amount of time in the gym, and now he's not like overly bodybuilder looking, but it looks like a guy who takes his exercise seriously.
Yeah. He looks pretty solid.
Mm-hmm. But he's described as being charming, warm, and strong. He came up through the ranks with Avar, Stellan, and Elzar, but they don't really have the like same circle of friends necessarily. Mm-hmm. And meanwhile, Amadeo is his wide-eyed and eager to learn Padawan. So I don't know about you, but these two look fantastic. I'm excited to see what they get up to in Phase 3.
I agree. And I have a feeling that these two are going to be a pair that we're going to get invested in. And by golly, they better not take them from us.
You're here. Okay. And then the other new Jedi characters that we got are Gavi, Kildo, and Tep-Tep. And these three are Jedi younglings that feature in Daniel Jose Older's upcoming middle grade novel, which comes out on January 30th, 2024. It's called Escape from Valo. And we get a little bit of details we got is that when Padawan Ram Jamaram, who we met in Phase 1, mm-hmm. is headed into the occlusion zone, and he's joined by some Jedi younglings that happen to be these three. So we've got Gavi, who is a young human from the Jedi Temple in Valo, which is now in the occlusion zone. And when he saw one of the Nameless kill a Jedi Master, he was traumatized and lost his ability to use the Force, and he is developing some romantic feelings towards Kildo. Meanwhile, Kildo is an Alsadian, which is a Nevavian species. He's kind of described as the class clown. He never turns down a chance to play pranks, and sometimes he struggles with with focus and the rules. And then finally, we got Tep-Tep, who's an Alsadian girl, and these again, one of these avian species. She's a bit of an animal whisperer. She's also described as shy and everyone's little sister. So I'll be frank, these three seem a bit too precocious for my liking. It is a middle grade novel, and I'm not the target audience for that. I acknowledge that up front. I'll read it because I'm a completist when it comes to these things. But
yes, you are.
These three didn't particularly excite me, but what did you think?
Well, the Alcidian really intrigues me, though, because especially from the concept art, this mm-hmm. new avian species. I'm not familiar with Alcedians. Are you?
No.
Okay, so this is like a brand new, I mean, I know we have like 100,000 different species in Star Wars, and we're usually, you and I are usually pretty good about a lot of these alien species, but yeah, this is definitely new. Tap Tap does seem to be really sweet, though. I love the idea of this little animal whisperer, and she had the little baby Nexu in her arms, so I just think that's super cool. But yeah, some of these middle grade novels, I've kind of avoided a little bit just because, like you, some of the characterizations is kind of, yeah, okay, I could have done without that. You know, maybe a little bit in passing here and there is fine. Like, I need to know who they are, but do I really need a whole story about them? I don't know. But, you know, knock yourself out. And I'm glad to see it. I'm glad to see all these new pieces of media come out. So, yeah, so it gives, again, you know, a lot of ability to pick and choose our favorites.
So I looked it up while you were talking, and I did not realize this because I am dreadfully behind, but apparently there's an Alcedian in Dr. Aphra in the second volume, which started in 2020.
Really?
The first appearance was in Dr. Aphra number 16, and then this character regularly appears like through issue 31, and then there's one also listed in Hidden Empire issues 1-3. So I'm a little behind on my comics, so I'm going to have to catch up and learn more about that character. So
interesting.
Yeah, interesting. I didn't before until you mentioned about them being, whether they were new or not, I had no idea. So anyways, so we'll have to read some of that and get back to y'all. So
now, is that from Wikipedia?
Yeah.
Is that where you got that? Okay. Because mm-hmm. I'd like to see also, you know, just little things about what are some of their traits and attributes. I like learning that kind of stuff. Kind of a xenobiologist, if you will.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I was like, yeah, I up until you said something, I hadn't even thought to look whether they were new or not. Okay. Well, we also have some new Nile characters they're not actually really new. Yeah. The first one we've got is Baron Bulan, and we kind of talked about him last week when we were reading mm-hmm. an excerpt for Eye of Darkness, and he of course is the Ithorian. He was a member of the Path of the Open Hand. He is now Marcion Rowe's Minister of Advancement, and by that he is responsible for conducting experiments that turn ordinary Force users into vicious berserkers and hunters. And as a side note, ministers have replaced Tempest Runners in the Nile. He's also been doing experimentation on the Nameless to make them even more terrifying than they were already. He has bases across the Occlusion Zone that houses experiments, and they are patrolled by Children of the Storm. So that is an interesting phrase, Children of the Storm, because we know we had the Children of the Path of the Open Hand that worked for the Mother. So is this a blending of that? What exactly is the connection there?
Yeah, and interesting because we're getting back into that nomenclature, if you will, of ministers versus Tempest Runners as mm-hmm. well. So that's kind of getting back to that too. So, interesting.
Well, and we learned that Geostaros was trying to do some reorganization of the Nile.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I suspect that was her doing is to.
Yeah, that makes sense.
Because she's like the Minister of Communication or something like that. So that's her role there. Now we've got
branding.
Yeah, we've got Niv Drindau Apruk, and he is one of Bulan's students. He's a teenager. He's considered a genius in the field of demented biological research. Put that on your resume.
Yeah.
And he is basically described as being terrible at everything else in life. So he seems to be something of a basket case.
This cracks me up. So first of all, just the concept art for this, mm-hmm. he does look freaky. And then just the way that he's described, and they said that his first name is Niv Drindau. So mm-hmm. don't make the mistake of thinking that Drindau is his last name. It's Apruk. And so I couldn't help but to think, like, how fun would that be to have been in there creating this character and just basically saying, okay, he's this crazy demented genius of biological research but terrible at everything else in life. I just that mm-hmm. cracks me up. So I'm super intrigued by this character, not gonna lie.
Yeah, to me he looks like he's an Umbaran, which is what Slymore was, but
yeah,
is that what you're thinking?
Yeah, so, that's perfect. That is perfect.
Yeah, I don't know that. They didn't say that explicitly, but...
No, I think you hit the nail on the head with that.
Right. Yeah, so, yeah, we'll see what happens with that character. And then the last one that they talk about is General Vice, also not a new character. We got to meet General Vice in the Blade comic series that Charles Soule wrote. That was in Phase 2. General Vice is now in the service of Martian Rowe as the Minister of Protection. And, yeah, I'm not sure what else to really say about her. They didn't give us a whole lot more details there. I mean, she was that mercenary general in Phase 2, and now she's thoroughly aligned herself with the Nile.
And you know what I've really noticed a lot of with the High Republic is that, I hate to say all of a sudden, but we're getting a lot of these species that have really long longevities, where it used to just be kind of like Yoda's species was about the only one besides Wookiees that really had such a long lifespan. And now we've got General Vice, who was part of Phase 2 and now back in Phase 3. Mm-hmm. So it's like really, really long lifespan. That's, and she's a Miri Allen, correct?
Yep. Yeah.
Okay. Yep.
Well, and prior to hearing that Vernesta Rowe was going to show up in the Acolyte, we all had been on the impression that Miri Allen's had the essentially about the same lifespan as a human. And you know, we're kind of learning that it's considerably longer than a human's. So.
Right. Oh, I'm glad you pointed that out too.
Yeah. And the only thing I've noticed is that on the concept art for all three of these characters, as opposed to having the three blue slashes that go across like their forehead, they've all got the Eye of the Nile depicted somewhere on their uniform.
Yes. And I'll tell you what, these costumes are fantastic. And the detail that went into them is just great. So yeah, you see that blue whorl somewhere, even whether it's bisected by the middle of a robe. I mean, it's still there in some way, shape, or form.
Yeah. So that seems to be the replacement for the lightning strikes. But, okay. And so that's what we've got on Phase 3 of the High Republic. One last story. And we've been doing this a lot lately, Jay, but talking about either directors and producers talking about their upcoming or rumored projects or what they would have done had they had a Star Wars project and the like. But now we're getting an update from Taika Waititi. And he's been out promoting his new movie, you know, Nick's Goal Wins, which is, I think, about like the Samoan soccer team trying to get into the World Cup, and which is a comedy. And if you go to the movies, it's hard not to see that trailer this day. But he was doing an interview with Ash Carson from E.T., and he was asked about his future Star Wars movie. And his response was, at the moment, I'm still developing something with them being Lucasfilm. Like me, they have a lot of projects going on. I think they're going to push it until I finish these other projects. I've got about four other scripts that I'm trying to finish. My thing is I want to take my time with that and get it right. I don't want to rush this movie. So having heard that from Taika Waititi, what do you think?
Ooh, that we might be lucky to get it in this decade.
Perhaps.
Or ever. Yeah, exactly. I mean, I still have hopes and I would love to see what Taika brings to the Star Wars table. But yeah, at this point, it sounds like, gosh, four other scripts. Holy cow. That could really be, talk about pushing it out there. Ooh.
Yeah.
Think.
Well, I don't know. I got mixed feelings about it. You know, we talked about this some months ago when Kathleen Kennedy was asked about his movie. And she said that that's something that they're still definitely working on. That Taika is just really slow when it comes to writing these scripts. And they were working, trying to figure out the, like a third act for the movie, which I really think was like act two. You know, they know how it begins and know how it ends. It was like trying to connect the two acts.
Connect the dots, yeah.
Right. But I can't help but be reminded a little bit of the situation with Rian Johnson, which is, it's always like, oh, it's something we definitely want to do, but he's just so busy. It's something we want to do, but he's just so busy. And we talk about this all the time, but he's so busy. And I have no confidence that those movies by Rian Johnson are ever getting to get made. And frankly, I'm losing confidence that this will ever get made. So I'd like to see it, don't get me wrong, but it seems like Taika is more interested in just doing some other things.
Yeah, it really does. And you know what? If it's meant to be, it'll happen. I mean, we've already got our announcements of the movies that are, I hate to say definitely on the table, because at this point, as we know, nothing is definite. Right. But, you know, I'm looking forward to those. And if we do happen to get something from Taika at some point, then yeah, bring it on. But like you, definitely not going to hold my breath. That's why I was saying this decade, maybe, if ever. Right. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I know Bob Iger recently did the Disney earnings call. And one of the things he was talking about there was that they have been so focused on getting a quantity of properties available, not only in the theaters, but on Disney Plus. Mm-hmm. That they kind of lost sight of quality. And so they are reevaluating their approach to doing like everything. Mm-hmm. And so, and I think he was primarily speaking in the context of Disney and Pixar animated films, but I feel like it also stretches to what's going on in Lucasfilm and the MCU as mm-hmm. well. And so, although we have all these big plans, or we've heard all these great things about Star Wars movies coming out like that, I wouldn't be surprised if it gets shuffled some more. And these come out slower than what was originally intended. And I'm fine with that if they're going to invest the time to get the quality out there mm-hmm. and not just getting a movie out for the sake of getting a movie out.
Oh, I totally agree. And as much as I love seeing Star Wars on the big screen, it almost makes me wonder, too, where the future of these types of things are going to go, because I was reading up on that, too, with the fourth quarter earnings and everything. And mm-hmm. that Disney added 7 million core subscribers to Disney Plus in the fourth quarter. So, I mean, that speaks volumes when it comes to, you know, where is their viewership right now? Mm-hmm. And where do they want to put the money into bringing these projects? And so, yeah, like I said, as much as it'd be great to see these on the big screen, I almost wonder if it's going to be more of a focus on, you know, like you said, with the MCU and Star Wars as well, they've had all these amazing series on Disney Plus, and is that going to be more of the focus for, you know, the bread and butter, so to speak? So it'll be interesting to see where it goes.
Well, a couple of things. I know they've announced that Disney Plus is going to merge with Hulu into a single app, and I believe mm-hmm. that's going to be done by the end of March. And so you're going to have more content under one umbrella. I don't know what that means if you have a separate subscription to both.
I was wondering that when you said that. I was like, how's that going to work?
Yeah, but that's neither here nor there. But my point being is that they're going to have more content available on one app. And I also feel like they are under the impression that when it comes to their movies, they're not maximizing the theater dollar and revenue that they're making out, because due to COVID, we all got trained into, you know, learning that, hey, these movies come out like 3 months after they're released in theaters, if that. I mean, mm-hmm. sometimes like 8 weeks, 10 weeks. And so if you don't want to fork over the $15 per person to go see it in a theater, well, it's included in your $10, $15, whatever it is, monthly subscription. And you can just watch it in the comfort of your home. So I would not be surprised if there's a more deliberate approach to putting these movies together. They're put into theaters, and then we don't see them available for streaming anywhere for longer after mm-hmm. they've had their theatrical release, in the hopes of driving more people to the theaters to see the big events, as opposed to them realizing I can just wait for a couple months and then I'll be able to watch it at home.
Right. And I have noticed that trend starting back that opposite way that you're mentioning too, because mm-hmm. for example, Oppenheimer, I know, was very popular this last summer. And so far, unless I'm mistaken, I don't think it's available for streaming anywhere, even if you try to pay for it. Because I know the mm-hmm. Barbie movie is out on Amazon right now, but you have to buy it. I don't think they've even gone to the renting option as of yet. And we're talking, you know, what, 4 or 5 months ago that came out in theaters?
Right. And as you're talking about that, I looked it up, and yeah, you can purchase Oppenheimer through the various streaming outlets, but no, I don't see that's available for streaming on, mm-hmm. you know, as part of a subscription anywhere just yet. Mm-hmm. So,
all right. Well, there you go.
Okay. Well then, that'll do it for this longer than usual episode of the news. We haven't had one that's been this long, but I think, you know, the strike did a lot for us in that regard. Sure. So, but yeah, so with fun. That, yeah, definitely. Just want to thank you all for catching up on Star Wars news with us here on this episode of Podcast Stardust. We hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, then make sure you hit that subscribe button on your podcatcher so that you can catch all future episodes of Podcast Stardust automatically. I'd also like to remind you, you can find all episodes of the podcast over on retrozat.com, which is also home to several other great podcasts covering everything from the MCU and DC to Dune, Star Trek, and a whole lot more. As always, we greatly appreciate your 5-star ratings and reviews on whatever podcatcher it is that you use, especially if that's Apple Podcasts. And please don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes on social media with your friends. So speaking of which, Jay, you want to give everybody what all those contacts are for us one more time?
Absolutely. And just want to say hello there to all of our new listeners. I know we are continuing to grow with every episode, and Dennis and I definitely do appreciate that. And for those of you that have been with us for 4 years as well, so you can keep spreading that show love out there on Twitter or X, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we do have a Pinterest page with lots of boards, and our YouTube channel is a really convenient way to find us. And that does have all of our past episodes all the way back to number one up to this one, 652. So head over there, like, and subscribe. And we do have a Discord room on the RetroZap Discord server. So as Dennis was just mentioning, there's a lot going on over at RetroZap. And so if you want to get in on some of that real-time chatter, just head to our show page, click on that community tab, and you are there. And if you are in need of some new swag, you know, you need a new sweatshirt for cozying up these cold winter months here coming up, we have a Tee Public store with 7 different show logo designs available. So you can head over to teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust and pick up one of those designs. And if you do pick something up, snap a picture and tag us on one of those social media outlets that I just mentioned. So Dennis, what else is going on these days?
Not a whole lot. Warp Trails, which is the podcast I host with my wife, Beth, and we talk about Star Trek, is on a hiatus while we wait for season 5 of Discovery to come to Paramount Plus. But once that's there, then you can catch the two of us talking about it over on the RetroZap podcast fleet. Just look for the episodes Warp Trails. But if you want to find our conversations about all the other Star Trek shows, then just head over to RetroZap.com and look for the Warp Trails page. That is the most efficient way to find us. Jay, what is the latest in the world of cosplay?
All right. Well, you can always find me over on my Instagram, which is at j.snipscosplay, celebrating the amazing characters of Ahsoka Tano and Hera from both the Ahsoka series and the Rebel series, Ahsoka from the Clone Wars. And I also have the Fourth Sister Inquisitor from the Kenobi series. And I'm also working on an original concept Mandalorian. Really excited to hopefully debut that one early 2024. So I'll be heading to GalaxyCon Columbus at the beginning of December and posting all kinds of fun stuff about that. But until then, join me for all the fun over at j.snipscosplay.
Okay, so upcoming on the show, on Monday, we'll have the next installment of our look at From a Certain Point of View for Return of the Jedi. And then on Wednesday, we have our final segment in our Return of the Jedi series that we've been doing, analyzing small chunks of the movie. So make sure you join us for that. Okay, but until then, thanks for listening to episode 652 of Podcast Stardust, everyone. Have a great life day and have a great weekend. And until next time, may the Force be with you.